Well, this is going to be interesting.
This is either going to be an extremely informational or a total train wreck.
I'm betting on train wreck.
I'm betting that we will be on Amazon 20 minutes after this is finished buying everything we actually need to do this.
Yeah, including two other people to host the show. By the way, it's nice of you to wear pants this go around.
Just saying, when you see me, you ever notice you only see me.
A little behind the scenes. Now you know what goes on. This is Build Your Bottom Line, a production of Treadstone Risk Management. I'm Matt, and this is...
I'm Alan.
Hey, Alan. How are you?
I'm the on-air beauty, talent, brains, personality.
I'm just here because I have...
He's the Treadstone part of it.
I have to soak up some hours. So anyway, as a reminder, like, comment, subscribe, share, hit the notification bell, retweet, help us put this show out there to get people some of the important information that we talk about every single week at 8:30 on Thursday. So I'm going to take that banner down. And yes, I'm trying to use my cell phone to manage the technicals here.
Yeah, we're trying something new today. We're going balls to the walls on this.
Not literally. All right, please think that.
This is not for that. I have an OnlyFans account. I'll post that link later.
Yeah, that's completely unrelated to Treadstone. So anyway, so for this trial run of this new setup, we are speaking about what?
We are talking about the things that your company should have a zero tolerance policy for.
Mm.
And that when we say zero tolerance, we of course mean across the board.
Yeah.
Not only for some employees.
Like losing money and hiring him. Don't do either.
This is 100%. Tolerance.
That's complete tolerance. We want complete tolerance of hiring you.
You need it, because let me tell you something. When you hire me, I tell you like it is, and you generally don't want to hear the truth.
So, as I included in the show notes, there are certain things, actually most things, that you want to have a progressive discipline policy for, right? So, someone, you know, whatever, says a bad word at work.
Yeah, attendance policies are a prime example of progressive.
Yes.
Discipline.
Yeah.
What we're going to be talking about today is zero tolerance, where if somebody does it, they're gone the minute they step a foot in your office.
We're talking about ruling with an iron fist.
A hammer fist.
Not diamond fist. That's a complete...
No. Diamonds are too expensive. Let's be real. This is pre-pandemic.
So why, before we even get into like the specifics,
yes,
which are the really fun things to talk about.
Right. The exciting part of insurance.
Yeah. They make for good stories after you take care of the problem. But so why would an employer want to have a zero tolerance policy?
Liability. Mm. Numero uno. You do not want to be held accountable for something that one of your idiot employees has done that breaks all social, moral, and ethical norms.
Sometimes only like one of them, but then sometimes all of them.
I mean, you gotta kind of pick and choose your battles, but there are certain things where there is no picking and choosing. You need to let them go immediately.
Yes. Yeah. And so there are certain infractions that are so, it's like the seven deadly sins, right?
Yes.
There are certain infractions that are so extreme that you will actually invite additional liability onto you and your company by keeping them around and thinking that, like, you know, you will try and fix the problem over time or something, right? So let's talk about some of them. First of all, most of these things you need to lay out in your employee manual.
Yes. We harp on this shit every week.
Yeah.
Employee manuals.
Yes.
You need to have them. They need to be signed. They need to be enforced.
Pretty soon, we're going to get a Teespring account.
Yes.
That's going to have a template for tattoos that say employee manual on them.
And
you can put them anywhere you want on your body. We'll have various sizes,
yes,
too.
I cannot describe enough. The two things I have harped on since day one, manuals and contracts.
Yes.
You need both of them. If you don't have them, get them. If you think you don't need them, you're wrong.
Wow. Listen,
that's what you get when you hire me as an ops manager. I will tell you, you're wrong.
So other than just production quality, we might have to change the tenor of the program.
Yeah, we'll go a little lighthearted shortly.
So have it in your employee manual. What are some of the examples? What's like one of the first ones that kind of comes to mind?
Obviously, number one. And I've seen people make videos of this on social media making fun of it. Sexual harassment.
Mm.
Number one.
Yeah.
If you have an employee approach you and say, so-and-so is making inappropriate comments, sending me inappropriate texts, sending me inappropriate emails, there is no, okay, well, we'll look into it. No. If there's one thing that, you know, you can call whatever you want, social activism, woke culture, cancel culture, whatever you want to call it. The one thing they have right is sexual harassment is zero tolerance. If you have a guy doing it, he's got to, or a girl. I mean, trust me, it can happen both sides of the gender spectrum. There is no, like, we'll look into it, but keep working with them.
No. Where on the doll did she touch you?
So let me tell you what happened was.
I would agree with you when you identify something's happened, yes. Right? You should definitely have a progressive communication plan, like an escalation plan.
Yes.
For like who talks to who, right?
Yeah. You're going to have some kind of investigation into it.
Yes. Yeah. But if it turns out that there's like overt sexual harassment on the premises or on the clock, so to speak, or associated between two employees.
If they come to you with photos on their phone that they shouldn't be receiving, or they say, I have asked them not to send me these photos, you don't need to go any further with your investigation. It kind of ends at that photo.
And then you should inform the employee, especially if they're from like a New York congressman or something like that. They should probably go to the New York Post.
Or a Jets quarterback.
Oh yes, that's true. Yeah, yeah. A supposed Jets quarterback. Actually, no. Was he a Jets quarterback at the time?
Let's see. He was. No, I think it was after he retired.
I think that was more a Green Bay thing than it was. Yeah. Or was it after?
Well, I mean, it was a Green Bay thing because it was a reporter. But then it was after he retired that the story came out. But listen, either way, if you're sending pictures of your crooked cucumber,
never heard that before in my entire life. What? Dude, that's a thing?
Listen, I'm not from that's what the reporter said.
Yeah.
I'm not making this up. You can Google it. Feel free to follow the Googles.
Wow, I don't want to read the paper that reporter works for. So anyway, yes, sexual harassment. So if there is evidence that something has gone down like that, have a progressive escalation process, but once it becomes evident that something has happened, obviously, you need to have a zero tolerance policy because that kind of thing can have all kinds of wide sweeping, just calamitous things that can happen, right? Huge lawsuits, morale, hiring problems in the future, just a whole mess load of things. Those yes. things can infect your, organizational culture to the very core. So I would agree with that. I would say two is, and this isn't always the case, it depends on the circumstance, but substance abuse on the job.
Yeah.
So specifically in situations where obviously someone who is impaired is going to threaten or potentially injure other people, either on the job site or third parties.
Yes. Crane operators, heavy equipment operators.
DOT drivers.
Anything involving DOT.
Yeah.
You do not want the DOT looking into your company. Mm. They are ruthless. They are meticulous, and they will find every little thing that you've ever done wrong over like a 10-year span. That includes your logbooks, that includes your truck maintenance, that includes signage that you're required to have, your medical records for your DOT drivers. They do not mess around with you.
Yeah. Now, so there's two different sides of that, though. So, like, there is the side where it's, like, the individual has, like, a dirty test yes. that comes back. DOT, in most cases, has, like, a progressive discipline or at least, like, a rehab program.
They also have a second testing procedure where if your first test comes back with anything in it, they do a second test. If the yep. second test comes back, they can require your employee to get retested to verify. So it's not, there is a margin of error that they build into their testing program.
Yeah. But if it's outside of the realm of testing and they're like visibly intoxicated operating a piece of heavy machinery or I believe the phrase that they use is a safety sensitive position.
Yes.
That is definitely grounds for intense administrative decision making at that moment.
Yeah, we'll go with that.
We're not going to beat them or anything extreme. Like that, or you know,
extreme like the Doritos. Now, the other thing to remember is that if you have an employee who, and again, this is mostly, you know, a lot of this is DOT, but you probably should implement this in, even if you're not a DOT company. Accidents. If you have an employee accident, dropping a piece of equipment, crashing a forklift, crashing a vehicle, almost every time they're going to require an immediate drug test, drug and alcohol test.
Yeah.
That should be clearly laid out in your employee manual as well. So that everybody knows that if in the event of an accident, they are going to be required I believe it's within 20. There's a time limit. If it's a major accident, I believe it's within 8 hours. If it's a minor accident, I think it's 24 or 48 hours. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. It's been a while, but yeah. They require you to send your employee for drug testing. You are financially liable for that. You do have to pay for the test. You do need to have that lined out in your employee manual that if that happens, they are going to be required within those time frames, whatever it may be, to get that testing done.
Mm, yeah. And it gets more drastic, the more intense or more involved the accident is too. So that's also something to pay attention to. Not to mention the fact that there are also OSHA requirements associated with the number of people that are involved, or if a member of the public, third party from the public is involved.
Yes.
There are other recommendations as far as that goes as well. So that's a big one. Substance abuse. What would you say is another one?
Third one is going to be, weapons on a job site or at the job.
Well, that's a good one. Yeah.
Office. You know, that's another one, handguns, knives. There's all kinds of the list of crazy things that have been confirmed being brought to the office. You need to have a policy against your employees bringing those to the office.
Yeah.
Even if you're in an open carry state, whatever, it doesn't matter. You do not want your employees bringing weapons to the workplace.
I think that's something that's really important to mention is your policies and procedures. This comes up all the time with like marijuana and cannabis, right? You might be in a state that has legalized either medical marijuana and cannabis or even recreational, but you as an employer can still make, marijuana or cannabis consumption or use essentially a non-starter for your employees. Yes. Again, it has to be laid out, right?
Yes.
Same thing with, firearms, knives, things like that. All of those, and you can also be very general in terms of your terminology. So it can be any weapons. Like you could say no weapons, yes. On the job site.
There. Yeah. If you don't want to bring in baseball bats and crowbars, that's covered under weapons. Mm-hmm. But going back to what you said about the drug policy, it happened in Colorado. Regardless of the fact that it was completely legalized under federal law, it's still technically an illegal drug. Mm-hmm. So if you work DOT projects, guess what? It's still illegal.
True. Lay that out again, employee manual. All right. What's another one? Fraud and theft.
Fraud.
Yeah. That's another one. These come up all the time in insurance industry ethics continuing education courses.
They're very, trust me, you want to sit through those. They're exciting.
If you have insomnia, order one of those. It's like $5. It'll put you out immediately. But so anyway, these hypotheticals always come up. It's always like, an employee steals from your agency. Like, what do you do, right? Some people take a no tolerance tact. Other people don't. Here's something that's really important. In many cases, your insurance coverage will require you, if you want to seek, insurance coverage for the loss, your insurance coverage might require you to immediately fire the employee and press charges through the local law enforcement in order for that coverage to stick. So that's something to remember. We could get into fiduciary, best practices as far as risk management. That's a whole other thing.
Yeah, that's where you start going down a rabbit hole of what everybody in your company does. But yes,
stop stealing the pencils, damn it.
Well, you know what? Stop buying such nice pencils and I will. But yes, theft, fraud, anything like that needs to be laid out. You know, especially as you grow, once you hit, you know, your million, your 5 million, your 10 million, you need to know that one, the people, yes, exactly. When you're making it rain, you need to make sure that the people you're working with are held accountable to everything. Again, employee manual. All you have to say is theft. Any type of theft will be grounds for immediate dismissal. Yeah. That's it. It's one sentence, and it covers you.
Yeah.
That's why employee manual. Why we harp on it constantly. It is the lifeblood of your disciplinary actions.
Yeah. And that should include not just your company's assets, but if you're a type of company or organization that goes into other people's homes, takes custody of their property and their assets and things like that, you also have to lay it out there where the employees, if they steal anything from a client, that it's immediate expulsion. Because, I mean, you don't have to, but the problem is that, again, this is one of those things where it's really a PR thing. If all of a sudden the news starts to spread that, you know, you're a company that hires people that, you know, essentially steal out of other people's homes, you know, what do you think that's going to do to the potential pool of customers that and clients that you can eventually, you know, bring on board? So that is something to remember, is you're also having to protect the PR, yes, of your actual organization.
Yeah, I'm sure everybody's heard the stories of valets who take really expensive cars on joyrides.
I've never heard of those, really?
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't know. I've never had a really expensive car. But if anything, I feel bad for the valets when they have to get in my car.
That sounds like, well, no, I feel bad for when I have to drive in your car. What is that is like the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my entire life. You're talking like joyride, not like steal, right?
Yeah,
like,
no, joyride. I mean, you've heard of, they've crashed the cars. Guess what? You're liable for it if they crash. The car's auto insurance isn't going to be liable for it. You are. And
look, it's the Ferrari's fault for having so many horsepower.
Yeah, it's happened. It happens in New York City a lot, which is, I don't know, kind of funny to me, but that's just because I have a sick sense of humor.
And you don't like New York. I mean, that's
But I mean, you know, those are things that you need to have. That is a form of theft. They are taking your trust, and they are breaking all kinds of ethics and morals. And I mean, it's not their property. It's not your property. You are merely parking it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, anytime you are in the custody of other people's stuff, that is a trust. That's why it's called
care, you know, custody, and control. It's a very exciting phrase.
Oh yes. Yeah. That's a big one for insurance.
Yeah. Yeah. They love saying that in their paperwork.
Yeah. Whose responsibility is it? Well, whoever's in care, custody, and control. That's actually a really good kind of, not that it's interesting, but a lot of times, like, we get these hypotheticals where it's like, well, you know, do we need to be covered if, or is it our, you know, responsibility if? A lot of times it is care, custody, and control, right? So whoever has it is responsible for, you know, taking care of it and able to deploy it, use it, or move it around. That is basically what it comes down to. So, so that's another one. Stealing, theft, fraud. I mean, like I said, we could get into, you know, procedures to protect company assets and stuff like that. But I think that would be a whole episode in and of itself, you know, dual control and everything like that.
Yeah.
What's another one? You have any other ones that come to mind?
We've done theft, drugs, weapons, sexual harassment.
Yeah.
I mean, you could go off of, I mean, there's other ones that you can lay out. If you're in the construction company, you've ever had guys take the equipment to do side jobs, I mean, that's technically theft. Unless if you tell them that they can't do that. I know I worked for a company that had the guys do that once, and it didn't go over well with ownership. Turns out that, you know, when you're using their equipment to make money on a job that they could have made money on, it's generally frowned upon.
I also know of a couple of DPW supervisors in New Jersey that used to use town equipment and men to do landscaping at their own house. So, right, and I say used to because That didn't last very long.
We also know of a superintendent that used the high school janitors to do work at his own personal house.
Yes,
and yeah. that cost him quite a conundrum.
Yes, yeah. So I definitely the misuse of company assets, property, things like that. That is definitely a huge no-no. There's other things that are kind of like maybe industry specific.
If you were in a
professional setting, like an insurance broker or agent or an attorney or something like that, if, you know, instances of gross negligence, you don't necessarily have to offer a progressive discipline plan. If it is something that the individual knowingly did incorrectly or wrong, I mean, you do have the grounds. And in many cases, like I said, depending on what your insurance coverage is like, you might have the impetus to actually get rid of them pretty quickly without, you know, any kind of recourse. So,
yeah, Tom, telling falsehoods about contracts is a great way to get yourself fired.
Or signing applications for clients.
Signature forgery is a big one.
Certificates collage work is another one. You know, insurance certificate collage work is another one. Just speaking from the insurance world. Anytime this kind of like goes under like theft and stuff like that, but anytime you take in insurance, very highly regulated place, if you take customer premiums and you mix them with your own personal operating money, that is a gigantic no-no. It could get your agency completely shut down and your licenses taken away.
Goes back to that whole fiduciary responsibility.
Yes. Yeah.
They frown upon that very hard.
Yes. Yeah. In fact, I believe it or not, it's still to this day one of the most frequent sources of insurance agency fraud that happens is just, you know, they call it co-mingling. Happens in banking.
And saying it on act and saying, oh, I did it on accident doesn't fly.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I remember when I took my agent test, there was no less than three questions just on that. They want to hammer it into your head that you cannot take your clients' funds and mix them in any way, shape, or form. There's time limits on when I have to send it to the insurance company. There's time limits on when I have to do refunds. Everything is strictly controlled by the government.
Was it like a yes, no, or was it like a strongly agree, strongly disagree?
Neither. It was how many hours do you have to do it? And do you know the exact number of hours you have to do it?
I was going to say, like, look, you can come here for information other than just risk management. If you're ever taking a test and it's on a gradient of like that 1 to 5 where it's like strongly agree, strongly disagree.
Always strongly.
It's either strongly agree or strongly disagree. Forget the other three bubbles are there. In fact, when I got my first job with Prudential, like I scored a 99 on the test. And the people are like, holy crap, we've never seen this before.
What a freaking nerd.
They were like, how did you do that? And I was like, well, I answered everything strongly agree or strongly disagree. It's not rocket science. I mean, you know, come on.
I mean, when I took my motorcycle test, they gave me the wrong test at first, and they wound up giving me
And now you drive an 18-wheeler.
Yeah, no, I'm not making this up. I went in for my motorcycle test at the DMV. I won't say which one because, let's be real, they're all state agencies, and no one cares anyway. But I took the whole test, and then I realized about, like, I don't know, probably at the second to last question, I'm like, pretty sure they gave me the wrong test. So I went up to the proctor and said, hey, I think you gave me the wrong test, maybe for the motorcycle test. And they're like, oh yeah, you're right. That was the driver's license test. I failed the driver's license test. Now, keep in mind, I'd had my driver's license at this point for like 5 years. So the woman looked at me and goes, you have your license, right? I'm like, oh yeah, yeah. Why did you fail this test? And I didn't have an answer. I just looked at her and said, solar winds.
I was dead at the time.
So the testing procedures are actually that, you know what, speaking about testing now, that's another thing that you can have a zero tolerance policy for. If you have employees that have to have certain certifications or qualifying tests that they need to keep regular track of and they don't do it, that can be something that you can fire them for.
If they don't keep up with it.
Yeah, there was a job that I work where they used to have to take qualifying certifications. And we had a guy who, you know, they're on a pretty strict schedule, especially when you work on any federal projects. Most federal projects have a very strict schedule on keeping those tests active.
Mm.
And he was constantly skipping the tests, not doing them, or he'd do them halfway, and then he'd exit out of it to, you know, basically get a reset. And we told him, like, you know, we went to him and said, listen, this is an all or nothing. Either you pass these tests or you don't work. And he kept, so the next one he did the same thing. We're like, all right, well, then guess what? You're gone. This is not optional. It is a requirement of your job.
Mm.
So if you have employees that have requirements of their job that they need to maintain, whether it be certifications, physical fitness,
driver's licenses,
yeah, those are all things that you can hold them accountable for.
Mm.
Especially, you know, things like confined space. Confined space has very specific requirements that your employees must maintain. If they don't do it, then you can say, hey, listen, you're not working anymore. That's the way it is.
That reminds me, we should leave the parking lot at different times.
Why is that?
Because apparently you don't know how to fucking drive.
Don't worry about that. Listen, it only becomes illegal if the cops pull you over.
Clip that, censor it.
Save that for later. I'll need that for my defense.
Let's see. Those are the big ones that I got. I'm just trying to think of, I mean, like, anything in general that's deceptive, right?
Yeah.
That is deceptive on the part of an employee is pretty much grounds for a zero tolerance, you know, administrative decision.
I'll say this: deceptive usually happens if you have a sales force.
Mm.
That's where the deception and questionable practices come in. If you have a sales force that is highly based on not competitive pay.
Commission,
yes, yeah. Commission. You have to watch them because what you don't want is them telling your customers one thing and you can't deliver on those promises.
Mm.
I have worked in the past with a guy who would make promises that were not possible. You know, he'd say, "Oh yeah, we can do the job in 3 days." No, I mean, we're booked out for 6 months. There's no way to do that job in 3 days, and he would take the deposit based on that. Well, now you have to give the deposit back, and you as a business owner, you know, you look foolish. And in the days of Yelp and social media, that ruins your reputation quickly. You know, when people start calling you a liar on the internet.
Well, you know, 3 days, but, you know, when we start is relative. I mean,
I didn't say which 3 days. I just said 3 days.
Yeah. Spaced out over, you know, 180, you know. Deceptive practices, anything that really kind of like undermines your brand quality, your brand equity, and again, the kind of PR aspect of it too is a big one.
But this all goes into your employee manual.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Most of this stuff, you know, the employee manual, and we mentioned the employee manual a lot. Obviously, again, standard disclaimer, you know, get a labor attorney to look at your employee manual and review it every single year and have a labor attorney look at it every single year. It will cost you a little bit of money every single year, but believe me, when an issue comes up, that process will pay for itself and then some over time if you do that. But when you word it inside the employee manual, in certain instances, you want to be specific, and in other instances, you want to leave yourself some room to make an administrative decision.
Yes.
So you don't necessarily feel like, so we were talking about, you know, like weapons or articles, you know, dangerous pieces like that. So you don't necessarily have to lay out every single one, right? Like, it's not like you have to list every single type of thing. It can be, you know, give examples, but then the general policy can be, you know, just some general wording about, you know, unsafe or yes. What would be a word? You know, combative material, something like that.
Egregious.
But, yeah. Well,
I like throwing that word around.
You just stick that word in everything.
It makes me sound smart.
Egregious.
Like,
it's like judicial system. It's very tough.
Judicial.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I mean, same thing with the drug policy. I mean, you kind of have, as dumb as it sounds, you have to specify, you know, illicit drugs versus prescription drugs versus, you know, over-the-counter drugs. I mean, it sounds dumb, but you can't, you know, if somebody takes too much aspirin one day and makes themselves sick, you can't fire them because they made a mistake. Mm. If somebody comes to work drunk, however, and they have to operate the crane that morning, you have a little more leeway to get rid of them.
You'll love this one. So in some states, workers' comp is no fault. Yes. Right. Actually, most states workers' comp.
Most states.
And so there is the classic example. I think workers' comp attorneys have to answer this question all the time. There's the classic example of the janitor or the facilities maintenance person that comes to work drunk, didn't get drunk at the job, but came to work impaired, is mopping the floor, slips and falls on the same floor that they're mopping and injures themselves. And under certain circumstances, you could argue, well, that individual was impaired. I didn't have any knowledge of it, and therefore I shouldn't have to be, yes, you know, paying for their injury. But actually, in most states, because it is almost zero tolerance, that employee is covered under workers' comp. So this also has an application in terms of your long-term insurance cost. If you have employees that are impaired or doing the job unsafely and things like that, which is also something that we kind of talked about, but you know, if they are knowingly creating an unsafe condition, not just for themselves, but also, yes, for others, that could also be a zero tolerance policy, depending on how egregious it is. So, and like I said, leave your wording in your employee manual broad enough where you can make that, you know, determination.
Negligence is a real popular word with lawyers and insurance companies.
Oh yeah, they love that one.
They love that word. So yeah, if you heavy equipment operators, they're operating it with negligence, That's a zero tolerance. You want to get rid of those guys quickly because that is a word that's going to come back to bite you in the ass real fast.
They also like the word retainer.
Well, everybody likes that word because it just means free money.
Yeah. Well, upfront money. So, I think those are the big ones. I actually think this went halfway decently. Yeah. I don't know. I'll have to watch the playback.
Yeah. Obviously I'm going to have to see what I look like on camera. But
I think we're going to be signing up for Weight Watchers tomorrow is what I think is going to be happening.
Don't be ridiculous. I've given up on that years ago. At this point, what you see is what you get.
I'll be at the gym for the next 46 and a half hours. Thank you very much. Look, that was the first episode kind of in this format in person. You'll probably see a mix of, you know, this and the more remote kind of version, but as the world begins to kind of open up and things like that, we have more of an opportunity to also do some on-sites and like field work and things to put some episodes together. So we're going to try and mix that in as well.
Yeah, that's right. No more fears.
Oh, Jesus Christ. What happened? Cover your mouth first and then.
I was doing the wrong order. Yes. Yeah. We're going to attempt to make this a little more in person, a little more personable. Admittedly, missing the green screen, my fabulous house. You don't have to see my fabulous house, but
right there, Bruce Wayne.
My millions and millions of dollars.
With that, we will be back next Thursday at 8:30 p.m.
Oh, yes, yes, yeah. But and one more thing. This is my idea. He is not. But I would like to start featuring at least one charity a month that we can kind of promote and try to get their word out. So if you or somebody you know is running a charity, let us know. We'd like to feature them. We'd like to avoid the big chain charities and the ones that have national attention. We're looking more for the smaller ones that actually, you know, that actually help and have 100% of the proceeds go to helping people, not 2% of it, and the rest goes to their executive board.
So you know what the best nation in the world is?
Nation.
Donation.
Anyway, folks, this is the last episode, so I quit.
Turn out the lights. Back up the trucks.
Pay the metal. We're turning it into a parking lot. I'm done with this.
For more dad jokes, we will see you next week. Thursday, 8:30 p.m. Build your bottom line. Thank you. Have a good night.
Have a good night.
We'll be right back.